Welcome to Talk About It with Charlene Key. What's going on, baby?
How are you all doing today?
Man, doing good. I hope everybody doing good today, baby. So, we've been doing this 30 days of taming the tongue. I have learned a lot about me. And I've been breaking all the rules up until day number 7. So day number 8, I don't know if I broke this rule or not, but let's find out.
So I need you to back up for a minute.
I
And
back
we're
up.
going to be honest with people.
I have broke every rule.
All of us have every tongue in here probably we have broken at some point.
At some point.
And that's the thing, when we can admit it, and that's so big that you said that, baby, because when you can admit you fall short in the area, then that's when God can do the deliverance and God can do the healing and make us more like him.
Exactly. So tonight we have none other than day 8, the self-depreciating tongue. Take it away.
So she says that she opens with the scripture in Exodus 4:10. Moses said to the Lord, "O Lord, I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor since you have spoken to your servant. I am slow to speech and tongue." You engage in self-depreciation when you think or speak by yourself as being of little or no worth, and thereby minimize the value of what you bring to the table or have to offer. Notice how Satan seeks to take us from one extreme to the other. Either he tries to make us boastful or bashful. He tries to make us think that we are da bomb, is how she has it. Which is slang for really hot stuff, or done bombed, totally blew it. She says, don't be ignorant of his tricks.
Don't do it. Don't do it. So basically, if I understand it correctly, it's basically like how people devalue themselves.
That's it. You hit the nail on the head.
How they just, I don't think I'm good enough to do that. I ain't saying that, y'all. I'm just saying what some people say. I know I'm good enough. I'm just saying some people may have low self-esteem, whatever they may like. I don't feel like I'm good enough to do that. Why don't you apply for the position? I don't think I'm good enough to do that position because, or what?
Qualifications, because of based upon what is said, they may say you need a 4-year degree or a master's in this. And in some cases, that may be the case. And if that is so and you don't have it, you can either go back for it if the Lord leads you, or it may not be the job for you.
Right. But I was hearing in a way where they like, even some people that do have those qualifications, they still feel as though they don't add up to the other people. That's in their arena, and they're just in their field. So they kind of like, well, I know so and so been doing this for like 15 years. I just 3 years for me. I ain't even gonna try. And you're devaluing yourself, and you're taking away from yourself, and stuff like that. So yeah.
Yes. Life circumstances can have that happen too. If you go through a traumatic experience, the enemy will try to come in and try to make you feel like, okay, then, that same thing. And then you'll start speaking it, and instead of casting down the vain imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself, high and lofty thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God.
Oh, no, I was just somewhat shaking.
Okay. So I thought you had something to
say. I do, but go ahead. No, go ahead.
So that's another thing to consider, life experiences. And when you're walking out that process of self-healing, God healing you, and you'll begin to recognize, well, I need to change my words, because if I want to see myself differently, then I have to speak differently. I want to think differently.
And also, let me go ahead and address this one. To the young folk and old people, stop devaluing yourselves down to whatever it is, whether it's just a sex object or whatever it is. Don't devalue yourselves to the point where you have no value and nobody wants to, because as some people call it, I heard somebody young say this, I don't know, body count. They ain't slept with so many people. Now nobody wants to deal with them because they have devalued themselves so much that it's no value left. You know what I mean? They feel as though there's no value left because somebody may be out there that may accept what they've done in their lives. That's all I'm saying.
Well, we think about it and biblically, and first of all, if you are a believer, then you shouldn't, there should be no fornication or no adultery or none of that. So that's first and foremost. And if you have fallen into that, then all you have to do is repent from your heart. And truly, repentance means to turn away from that thing. Not just say it out your mouth, because God truly sees your heart and he knows your heart. And then, you know, you want to really mean it, turn from it. And I just wanted to say this. There was a story in the Bible where there was a prostitute, and I'm trying to think of it, her name. I can't think of it, but she ended up being... can you pull it up? I'm trying to think of it. What is it? When the men came, the angels were there and they came knocking at her door. Gosh, what is this? I should have it. Should have that. Should know that.
Yes, I'm trying to pull it up on the fly.
Yeah. So what was her name? This, look up when she, look up the prostitute. Just look up prostitute.
Okay. All right.
And she became, it was a message that the Lord gave me called Sacred Thread. When it was coming and they had to put the blood over there, the scarlet thread. The Lord had given me a message some a year or two years ago in 2021, I think it was, and it was called the scarlet thread.
I haven't found it. Keep going.
You mean do scarlet thread? Oh, prostitute, right there, or either scarlet thread? Do scarlet thread?
Okay. Mm-hmm. Go ahead, baby. Okay, they're waiting on you.
See, he got them. He don't have those reels on. Bless his heart. Okay. So it doesn't say it up there. Okay, so, but what happened was she ended up saving these men and took them to the rooftop. She, when they came looking for the men, knocking at the door, she did not give them up. And because she didn't, she saved her home. This was a prostitute, and she ended up being, I think, I want to say it, I want to get that right. She ended up becoming the mother or something of the, I think, David's lineage. And I don't want to say the incorrect information. That's why I was asking you to look that up. But basically, just because you may, and they, he said they call it the body count or whatever that wording is, just because you have fallen into that, that does not mean that you can't get out of that. All you have to do is give your life to Christ. God will come in and he will cleanse you up, and you can be the next Deborah, the next Elizabeth, the next Mary. I mean, I'm just saying it's biblical, Bible people who were in the Bible who did major things for the kingdom of God. So that's all I'm saying. Don't devalue yourself. No, no, it's a lie from the pits of hell.
And also, let me clarify something too. I know you said when you first started talking about this, you said if you're believers, you shouldn't be doing X, Y, Z. Well, we're not talking to all believers. Everybody that's going to see this is not a believer. So we have to make sure that we understand that as well. Mm-hmm. Everybody is not a, everybody that we see is not, everybody that, we're talking to is not a believer. So let me keep reading as she looks at that. So consider the account of Jesus at the men who had been possessed by demons for a very long time. Jesus asked him, saying, "What is thy name?" And he said, "Legion," because many devils were entered into him. Luke 8 and 30, that's in the King James Version. A legion is a major unit of the Roman army consisting of up to 6,000 troops. You want to go ahead and, I knew you were looking at that. Go ahead.
I don't want to stop with you. Finish
okay.
Up.
All right. Okay. Legion was not this man's given name. Being possessed by a legion of demons was a temporary condition he had to come to accept as permanent reality. He dealt with the problem for so long that he labeled or defined himself by his experience, which is what we, some people tend to do. They feel as though they've been doing this for so long. That's who they are. in reality, that's not who they are. They just have become a product of their circumstances or wherever. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
So the passage that I'm talking about is in Joshua 2, and it says, and let me start with verse 1. And Joshua, the son of Nun, sent out Shittim, two men, to spy secretly, saying, go view the land, even Jericho. And they went and came into a harlot's house, harlot being a prostitute named Rahab, and lodged there. And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, behold, there came men in hither tonight of the children of Israel to search out the country. And the king of Jericho sent unto Rahab, saying, bring forth the men that are come to thee, which are in and into thine house, for they be come to search out all the country. And the woman took the two men and hid them and said thus, there came men unto me, but I was not whence they were. And it came to pass about the time of shutting of the gate, when it was dark, that the men went out. So she saved those men. And in turn, they told her, because she did this for them, that she's going to be saved. That scarlet thread, she was going to put that scarlet thread over her door. And that when the time came, that they were not going to, here it is, that behold, when we come into the land, thou shalt bind this line of scarlet thread in the window, is this verse 18, which thou didst let us down by, and thou shalt bring thy father and thy mother and thy brother and all thy father's household home unto thee. And it shall be that whosoever shall go out of the doors of thy house into the street, his blood shall be upon his head, and we will be guiltless. So what he was saying is basically, because she did this, as long as she had that scarlet thread over that doorpost, then that right there was going to bring her and her family out, because she did this. And it says also that Rahab, that prostitute, a Canaanite woman living in Jericho, in Joshua 2, sends two men and spies to Canaan before its conquest, and Rahab helps them. Rahab is also an ancestor of both King David and Jesus the Messiah. So you see what I'm saying, how God can change you in just a moment. It's a process. It's progressive change. But in that moment, God touched her heart. She recognized who those men's savior was, which was Jesus Christ.
Okay. Self-depreciation displeases God. When Moses complained that he was inadequate to lead the Israelites out of the Egyptian bondage because of his speech impediment, God became upset. The Lord said unto him, who gave man his mouth? Who makes his mouth deaf or mute? Who gives him sight or makes him blind? It is not I, the Lord.
Is it not I, the Lord?
Now go. I will help you speak, and I will teach you what to say. Exodus 4:11-12. So
that's powerful.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, because you think about it, he didn't let that part that was him that looked like it was that was devalued. He could have rejected what God, you know, asked him to do, which was speak.
In the beginning.
Right. But I'm saying he could have kept doing it and kept saying, you know, because of, you know, how he, well, you know, whatever he's saying, how he talked, whatever. Right. He could have kept letting that be something that held him back.
Right.
But he didn't. He eventually got up the nerve. And he just got up there and he trusted what the Lord told him to say. And he said it. So, all right, let me finish reading. What an awesome promise from an omnipotent being who cannot lie. We must reject the spirit of inadequacy. Without God, we can do nothing anyway. So he had to trust God to be able to talk anyway, because he, you know.
Right.
Because God didn't give him that.
That's right.
You know, he's
straight from the enemy.
He asked him, I didn't give you that. Mm. So it had to come from somewhere else. So, without God, we could do nothing. With him, we can do all things. Because of the reality of his word, we can walk in confidence, not in ourselves, but in the grace of God that empowers us. So, yeah.
So today's affirmation
Okay. I can read it today.
Now,
God is able to make all grace abound toward me
so that I will always have all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. All things.
All things, baby. You want to pray to folks?
Yes.
Yeah, so you want me to pray?
I can. So, okay. Father, we just thank you even yes. now for the word that has gone forth. We thank you, Lord God, even for the writer who has given this and want to help people tame the tongue, God. Yes. So we say even now we reject self-depreciation in the name of Jesus, and that we would stand steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in your work, Lord God.
Yes.
I pray over these people, God, and I pray that this will be encouragement and enlightenment to them in the mighty matchless name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. I'm going to tell y'all something. Listen. Boy, if you put on some readers, you can see a lot clearer.
Mm.
Boy, I'm telling you, like the scale was lifted off my eye when I put my these God. Things. But I was looking, I was like, well, this stuff was jumping all up. And now I can, it's like I can just touch it. It's just like I got some 3D glasses on or something.
That's so good.
Yeah, I'm just saying, y'all, you know, I just had to throw that in there. Just in case anybody out there don't want to wear your readers. You know, you go in them dog restaurants and then you got to pull out your phone, put the flashlight up there. It's you. I done that. But anyway, I'm just saying. But anyway, we thank y'all for, we thank y'all for joining. Talk about it with Shaw and Key. Until next time. We out.